Welcome to the lecture on the subject English literature. The theme of the lecture is the Romantic movement, the Lake Poets and their successors. Objectives. After the lecture, students should be able to define and explain the Romantic movement in English literature, the major principles of it. Identify the main characteristics of Lake School of Poets, early Romantic poets. Investigate the late Romantic poets. During the lecture, the following questions will be discussed. The first, the Romantic movement. The second, the characteristics of Lake School of Poets, early Romantics, and late Romantic poets, among them John Keats and Percy Bysshe Shelley. Romanticism, which was the leading literary movement in England for more than 50 years, was caused by great social and economic changes. The Industrial Revolution, which had begun in the middle of the 18th century, was not a sudden change from home manufacturing to large-scale factory production. Enclosing common land had begun in the 16th century, but in the second half of the 18th century, it became rapid and spread all over Britain. The peasants, deprived of their lands, were forced to go to work in factories. Under the influence of the French Revolution, the Irish peasants plotted a rebellion against English landlords. It broke out in 1798 but was cruelly drawn in blood. The British government took the lead in the counter-revolutionary wars against France. The belief of progressive-minded people in the ideal nature of the bourgeois system was broken. As a result of all these economic, political, and social changes, a new humanist movement sprang up at the end of the 18th century. Romanticism was a movement against the progressive of bourgeois civilization, which had driven thousands of people to poverty and enslaved their personal freedom. Writers longed to depict strong individuals who possessed grand and even demonic passions. The Lake Poets were a group of English poets who all lived in the Lake District of England, United Kingdom, in the first half of the 19th century. As a group, they followed no single school of thought or literary practice than known. They were named only to be uniformly disparaged by the Edinburgh Review. They were considered part of the Romantic movement. The three main figures of what has become known as the Lake School were William Wordsworth, Samuel Taylor Coleridge, and Robert Southey. They were associated with several other poets and writers, including Dorothy Wordsworth, Charles Lamb, Mary Lamb, Hartley Coleridge, John Wilson, and others. The Lake Poets School, or Bards of the Lake, was initially a derogatory term that was also a misnomer, as it was neither particularly born out of the Lake District nor a cohesive school of poetry. The principal members of the group were William Wordsworth, Samuel Taylor Coleridge, and Robert Southey. Dorothy Wordsworth was an auxiliary member who was unpublished during her lifetime, but she provided much of the inspiration for her brother William's work. There was a certain amount of additional irony involved in the school's perception by readers who were inspired upon reading the poetry to visit the area that's helping to destroy, in the mind of Wordsworth at least, the very thing that made the lakes special. In addition, many of the first and second generation practitioners of Romantic poetry had a complex and not entirely easy relationship with the lakes. For the most part, other Romantic poets either struggle with the Lake poet identity or come to define themselves against what the lakes seem to offer in poetic terms. The second generation of Romantic poets were drawn to the area by the Romantic vision of seclusion and by the perceived Republican views of the older poets, but found a different reality when they arrived. Shelley lived for 3 months in 1811 at Keswick, having been drawn to the lakes by reading the early Liberty and Equality by Southey, only to find that Southey's views had changed and that the lakes had been despoiled by manufacturers. Keats, in the summer of 1818, had a similar response to that of Shelley, finding his hero Wordsworth's house full of fashionable people and Wordsworth himself away, canvassing for the local Tory candidate. Keats moved on to Scotland, which provided him with the inspiration he sought. and where, in particular, he felt the influence of Robert Burns. Byron did not visit the lakes, but he ridiculed the isolation and narrowness of mind of the older lake poets, as well as of their embodiment of radical politics. The hale and hearty John Wilson provided an alternative take on the role of lake poet. He lived near Windermere between 1808 and 1815 and knew the older lake poetry well. His poetry reveals a physical response to the lake scenery and emphasizes companionship and energy as against Wordsworthian quiet and solitude. Among the late romantic poets were John Keats and Percy Bysshe Shelley. John Keats was born on October 31, 1795 in London. His parents were Francis Jennings and Thomas Keats. John Keats was educated at Enfield School, which was known for its liberal education. While at Enfield, Keats was encouraged by Charles Cowden Clarke in his reading and writing. After the death of his parents when he was 14, Keats became apprenticed to a surgeon. In 1815, he became a student at Guy's Hospital. However, after qualifying to become an apothecary surgeon, Keats gave up the practice of medicine to become a poet. Keats had begun writing as early as 1814, and his first volume of poetry was published in 1817. In 1818, Keats took a long walking tour in the British Isles that led to a prolonged sore throat, which was to become a first symptom of the disease that killed his mother and brother, tuberculosis. After he concluded his walking tour, Keats settled in Hampstead. Here he and Fanny Brown met and fell in love. However, they were never able to marry because of his health and financial situation. Between the fall of 1818 and 1820, Keats produced some of his best-known works, such as La Belle Dame sans Merci and Le Mire. After 1820, Keats' illness became so severe that he had to leave England for the warmer climate of Italy. In 1821, he died of tuberculosis in Rome. He is buried there in the Protestant cemetery. Keats died young. In his tragically brief career, cut short by tuberculosis, Keats constantly experimented, often with dazzling success and always with steady progress. John Keats' literary career amounted to just 3.5 years. It began in July 1816 after he passed the apothecary's examination at Guy's Hospital and lasted until late 1819. He wrote a few poems before 1816, but his career truly began after he left his medical training. Keats wrote 150 poems, but those upon which his reputation rests were written in the span of 9 months, from January to September 1819. Keats published 3 books of verse in his lifetime. The first volume, Poems, was published in March 1817. It contained 31 works, including Sleep and Poetry and On First Looking into Chapman's Homer. His third volume, La Mia, Isabella, The Eve of St. Agnes and Other Poems, was published by Taylor and Hesse in June 1820. It contained 13 works, including The Great Odds of 1819 and Hyperion. Keats' supreme achievement lies in his development of the ode. In just a few months, in 1820, he wrote Ode on a Grecian Urn, Ode to a Nightingale, On Melancholy, to Autumn. These poems served models for the countless other poets. The main theme of Ode on a Grecian Urn is the idea that the figures in the urn are free from time and simultaneously frozen in time. The figures never have to confront aging, and at the same time the man can never kiss the woman, and the villagers can never return to their town. This theme creates a paradox and also enforces the theory of the negative capability. The last two lines of the poem proved to be the most difficult to interpret, which is why they are places of quotations. Some believe that if it is the speaker is addressing the urn, then he is indicating his awareness of its limitations. If it is the urn addressing the speaker, then it is basically saying that all human beings need to know its beauty and truth and how they are the same. Percy Bysshe Shelley was born at Field Place near Horsham, Sussex on August 1, 1792. He was the first son of a wealthy country squire, the most radical of the English romantic poets. He called for the complete overthrow of the existing order. He was expelled from Oxford University because of his atheistic beliefs, quarreled with his wealthy father, was banished from home and ran off to Italy. His novels often featured main characters who succeeded at their objectives despite a lack of a firm moral code and literary situation that more closely resembled studies of nature than tales of choice. His famous works include Queen Mab, Prometheus Unbound, and anthology verse works as Ozymandias, Ode to the West Wind, To a Skylark, The Mask of Anarchy, which are among the most popular and critically acclaimed poems in the English language. Ode to the West Wind. The speaker of the poem appeals to the west wind to infuse him with a new spirit and a new power to spread his ideas. In order to invoke the west wind, he lists a series of things the wind has done that illustrate its power. Driving away the autumn leaves, placing seeds in the earth, bringing thunderstorms and the cycling death of the natural world, and stirring up the seas and the oceans. The speaker wishes that the wind could affect him the way it does leaves and clouds and waves. Because it can't, he asks the wind to play him like an instrument, bringing out his sadness in its own musical limb. Maybe the wind can ever help him to send his ideas all over the world. Even if they are not powerful in their own right, his ideas might inspire others. The sad music that the wind will play on him will become a prophecy. The west wind of autumn brings on to a cold, barren period of winter, but isn't winter always followed by spring? During his brief stay at Oxford, where he remained for less than a year, Shelley had published two comparatively harmless attempts at Gothic fiction and poetry, as well as a prose pamphlet, The Necessity of Atheism, in 1811. That pamphlet was to have a disastrous effect on his relationship with his family and a dramatic effect on his life. Written mostly before he arrived at Oxford, Shelley's second Gothic romance, St. Irvine or the Rosicrucian, is notable for the appearance of a prototypical Shelleyan poet figure, though its two plots are hopelessly complicated and confusing, and in the opinion of many commentators, unfinished. It appears that in the early excitement of college life and other interests, Shelley lost interest in following through on what was to have been a full-blown three-decker romance. Shelley and Hawkes' joint collection of poems, Posthumous Fragments of Margaret Neilson, was purported to have been found and edited by John Fitzvictor, the two authors wisely having decided to place neither of their names on the title page in that age when both author and publisher could easily end up in prison on convictions of treason and sedition. The slender volume includes a mixed bag of poems, including Gothic and melancholy lyrics, as well as an anti-war, anti-monarchical poem simply titled War, notable for being the first appearance of Shelley's lifelong attack on monarchian and all authority figures. Shelley's style of writing. Shelley is still the subject of keen debate. His strangeness was a part of his originality, and he paid its price. To most of what was complex, institutional, traditional in his milieu, he remained inaccessible, intransigent. In conclusion, we can say, the connection of the Lake poets to Romanticism also encompassed a love of liberty and radical political convictions. The poets had to varying degrees sympathized with the French Revolution, believing that France was Europe's champion of liberty. Immersed in their love and worship of nature, the lake poets also believed in the spirit of reform through revolution, while maintaining that the union of the soul with nature was of primary importance. During the end of the 18th century and the early years of the 19th century, they were sheltered from the affairs of the world in their lake country homes. John Keats was one of the main figures of the second generation of Romantic poets. Percy Bysshe Shelley was one of the major English Romantic poets, widely regarded as one of the greatest lyric and philosophical poets in the English language. This is the end of the lecture. In order to check your understanding, answer the given revision questions. The first, what century was the progress of the Romantic movement? The second, who were the lake poets? The third, name key figures of the late Romantic period. And the fourth, when were born John Keats and Percy Bysshe Shelley? At the end of the lecture, you are given glossary. There are some references for further study.